I want to thank God, hallelujah, for one of my special daughters who came all the way from Canada.
Hallelujah.
Miss Barbara, let's thank God for her life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I want to thank God for Brother Jeff. Hallelujah.
Amen.
My own brother here. I always forget your name. What's your name again? Renan. Amen. Let's thank God for his life. Come on, somebody. Give glory to God for your life. Jeff was playing some keys, and I didn't even know what keys he was playing. Which means that he is all around. If you play African song, you play.
Amen.
If you play Asian song, you play.
Amen.
May the Lord bless you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And I want to thank God for Sister Elliot.
Amen.
I want to thank God for Sheldon. I want to thank God for Linda.
Amen.
I want to thank God for all of you. I want to thank God for our church members here. May the Lord bless you so much.
Amen.
All the workers in this house, may God bless you.
Amen.
We pray that wherever Pastor Kofi is, may the Lord also touch his life.
Amen.
For to prepare him for greater ways. Amen.
Yes, Lord.
We give God the praise.
Amen.
We give God the honor.
Hallelujah.
For all the things that he has done.
Amen.
My prayer tonight is that everybody will catch Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Everybody will catch the power of God.
Amen.
Before you leave here.
Amen.
Somebody shout, Amen.
Amen.
Thank God for my brother. Amen. My brother, how are you? God bless you for coming.
Amen.
You've been coming for all the revival. May God bless them.
Amen.
Take your Bible. Take your Bible. I've entitled a message tonight, The Struggling Soul of the Believer. The Struggling Soul of the Believer. In this life that we are living, it's a life I call uncertainty. Hallelujah. This life that we are living is like a marriage. Because marriage is forever. Until one is dead.
Amen.
Well, guess what? The Lord said to me that we are married to Jesus. And the Bible says, he who put his hand in the blood and look back is not fit
Amen.
In the kingdom.
Glory.
What does it say? Or what does it mean? It means that the moment you come to Christ and you accept him as your Lord and Savior, you have committed yourself to him. You cannot
Amen.
Go back.
Amen.
So you become what we call spiritual marriage.
Mm.
Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
What is Holy Spirit telling you recently concerning the mean, the real meaning of marriage? Marriage is simply mileage. You didn't hear. Marriage is mileage. How many mileage do you have on your car? Meaning that it's unstoppable journey. And you don't know what is ahead of you. You don't know what is coming across of you. You don't know. But we take this journey by faith.
Hallelujah.
It's by faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God.
Amen. Amen.
Therefore, with faith, we must come to him boldly and depend on him, trust in him, and do and make that step of faith until the hour or the time it's come for our God to take us home.
Yes.
As you can see, ladies and gentlemen, physically, spiritually, everybody is growing. Nobody will stay a child, whether you like or not.
Amen.
You will grow. A time will come.
Amen.
You have a bald head.
Amen.
A time will come. You will have, wrinkles on your face. A time will come. All your beauty will begin to fade. You know what? It's giving you a sign that you are heading towards your death. In other words, you are about to go and meet your God. The question here is, are you ready?
Hallelujah.
So that is why every single chance we have, we must
take advantage
it
of it.
With all our
yes.
hearts.
Amen.
To please the Lord.
Amen.
Somebody shout, amen.
Amen.
Today, I am going to speak a little bit about the experiences of Paul the Apostle. Paul the Apostle went through what I call struggling soul. He went through a struggle. His soul went through much struggle. Hallelujah. As he walked through his life. And the Lord said to me that we should use Paul's example as a picture. Hallelujah. To and learn and experience as we also struggle to please God and to become like Him. Somebody shout, amen.
Amen.
The main reason why everybody is struggling to please God is because we all want to be conformed into the image and the likeness of God.
God. Yes.
But my sister, I'm telling you, I know many people who are coming to church, who goes to church, who pray 24/7, but still their life are not conformed to the image and the likeness of God.
God.
Somebody shout, a big hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So, this scripture we're about to read, the Lord said to me that Paul was not afraid to make some confessions to the church of what he is going through within his body. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
I was teaching my daughter to you about something. That in life, there are two afflictions man must go through.
Hallelujah.
The cup of affliction and then the baptism of affliction.
Yes.
The cup of affliction is what goes on within you. When you have a battle mind, hallelujah, mind battle is within you. When you are going through pain in the heart, it's within. When things are not going well, it's within. And nobody can know except you tell them.
Amen.
Are you getting the point?
Amen.
So that one is called cup of what? Affliction. Mm-hmm. And then we have baptismal affliction. Baptism is what your outer body is going through.
Mm.
Get what I'm saying? What your mother is doing to you.
Mm.
What friends are doing to you. The people that you don't even expect doing to you. Going through all kinds of atria, betrayal, disappointment, rejection, pain, anxiety, all kinds of things. All these ones are for outer affliction. We have inner affliction. Now, in this message I'm about to speak to you about, Paul was going through inner affliction. And he came to a point that now he couldn't hide it any longer. So he decided to make confession of all the things that he was experiencing in the body.
Yes.
Praise be to the Lord to his name. Somebody shout a big hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, the Lord began to speak to me concerning this body. The Lord said to me that anytime you look at human body, hallelujah, picture Genesis, what took place in Genesis. In the beginning, God created heaven and earth. And the earth was what? Without form.
Without form.
And there was darkness
yes.
on the face of the earth. So that means that light was not born yet.
Mm-hmm.
Are you getting the point?
Amen.
Light was not born yet. And then the Lord decided to mingle light with darkness. How he did that, I don't know. But he did it. And the Bible said that, let there be light. And guess what? Light did not come to kill darkness. Came to separate it. So that is why we have darkness and what? And light. Whether you like or not, they are brothers.
Yeah.
So the Lord begins to compare that picture to our body. Every human being, you are two, whether you like or not.
Mm-hmm.
When God created Adam, Adam was, let me use that statement, darkness. Are you getting the point? And then later on, the Lord God introduced light. Are you understand? So the body was formed and then God breathed into man's nostril. And then that is how we got body and soul.
Mm-hmm.
So watch this.
The soul belongs to God. The body belongs to the earth. Glory be to his name. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
But the body is an enemy. So is darkness an enemy. So when Jesus came, darkness was overcome. Hallelujah.
Amen.
In the same way that the body and the spirit are in competition, are in opposition to one another. Are we getting a point here? So watch this. God intentionally put these two, these two together so that he would teach humanity how to please him. The only way a man can please God is to have dominion, control over the flesh.
Amen.
So in the garden, God left them in that garden to test them by mixing the body and the soul together to see if man will be able to overcome their lust in the flesh. Because the lust is comprises with all kinds of surprises. And I mean lust. Lust within that rises and tries to choke the spirit and make it slave. So the Lord said that the only way one can please God, the only way one can be accepted in the presence of God and become like him, is to come out from the flesh and be conformed, be transformed to the very image of God. That is why, watch this. You see this body, the Bible said, flesh and blood cannot inherit. That means that this flesh cannot see God. But the question is, why did God then create the flesh? God has created the flesh so that humanity will have what we call a battle to fight in order to see God. So I told you guys, all these revival others, anybody that try to escape trial and tribulation, you cannot see God.
Amen.
But it's through trial and tribulation that man is drawn closer to God.
Amen, amen.
So the other day, Jesus said, I cannot wait to be crucified on the cross.
My
because
God.
Without crucifixion, there is no glorification.
Amen. That's right.
So God intentionally brought these two together so that man can find their way out of their condition, of their situation, to meet God. I said it. I said that the Red Sea was very close to what? Sinai. And the only way for the people to see God was to go through what? Red Sea. Anybody that refuses your Red Sea, you cannot see Sinai.
Amen, 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 amen.
Are we getting a point here?
Amen.
Paul is giving us a dangerous picture here. I want everybody to listen. Oh, glory be to your name. So I have one all the way to five confessions of a great man of God that we all touch. That he never had a problem. There are some of you sitting down here, you think that Pastor Mike don't have a problem. You think Prophet Kofi don't have a problem. Every man of God, every child of God, I don't care how spiritual and sanctimonious you are.
Yeah.
I say, you have a problem.
Amen.
And in that, you don't want to share it.
Amen.
Somebody shout at me, hallelujah.
Amen.
But Paul was not ashamed to share it to his church members so that his church members can learn from what he experienced.
Hallelujah.
Somebody shout a big
hallelujah.
So the first confession, let's start reading the book of Romans chapter 7, 14, go. Then I'll read it loud, please.
For we know that the law is spiritual.
For we know that the law is what?
Spiritual, come on.
But I am of the flesh.
But I am of the flesh.
Sold under sin.
Sold under sin.
For I do not understand my own actions.
For I do not understand my own action.
For I do not know, for I do not do what I want.
The things I want to do, that is what I keep on doing. Keep on.
But I do the very thing I hate.
Uh-huh.
Now if I do what I do not want, I agree with the law that it is good.
If I do what I do not want, then I agree with the law that it is what?
It is not good.
It is good. Keep on.
So now,
no longer I who do it,
but the sin that dwells within
me.
For I know that nothing good,
absolutely nothing good, dwells in me.
That is in my flesh.
See that? In the flesh. He's talking about the flesh. Keep on.
have the desire to do what is right.
I have a desire. Who is that? Who is that desire? Your soul, your body, the righteous one in your body have the desire to please God, but what?
But not the ability to carry it out.
But I don't have the ability to carry it out. Why?
For I do not do the good I want.
The good I want to do, I cannot do them.
But the evil I do not want is what I
only do. The evil I don't want to do is what I keep on doing.
Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I.
And for now, it is no longer I.
But sin that dwells within.
But something else that has been attached, oh my God, to the glorious body Christ of God. There are two people here, guys. I'm telling you, it's very good, guys. I'm telling you, man. The Lord was telling me recently that the soul of the human being is in prison.
Amen. That's true.
And you can look at yourself right now. Amen. This body is a what? It's a cell.
Yes.
And your soul is in there.
Yes.
How can you break out? Yes. It's a problem.
Jesus.
Now I'm telling you. The Lord told me that we are all in prison.
Yeah, that's true.
How can you come out? Look at what the apostle is saying. He's making confessions of where he is.
Oof, my Lord.
The things I want to do.
I don't do.
The things I want to do to please this master.
I can't.
Finish it.
So I find it to be a law.
Did you hear that? I found it to be a law.
That when I want to do right.
That in the time I want to do right thing.
Evil lies close at hand.
Evil is always present.
For I delight in the law of God.
So I love God. God knows I love him. God knows that I am called. The Lord knows that I'm a covenant with him. I know my spirit bear witness that Christ in me, hope of glory. But Satan, Satan, say no. I see within me that there is another law apart from the law of my mind.
Hallelujah.
Against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin.
He's making me captive to the law of sin. Keep on.
That dwells in my members.
Keep on.
Wretched man that I am.
Oh! Now look at what this man, great man of God, is saying. He's calling himself a wretched man. A wretched man I am.
Who will deliver me?
Who will deliver me from this
body of death?
Did you hear that? It's calling your body of death.
Mm-hmm.
Your body is dangerous. Guys, let me tell you something. Some of you don't understand. Listen. The greatest enemy is not the one outside.
That's right.
It's you.
The greatest enemy is not your sister or your brother's enemy.
It's you.
The greatest enemy, hear me, guys,
is
not your grandmother who is minding her own business somewhere, and because of your dream, you are telling them that they are witch. Hello? Your greatest enemy!
It's you.
It's you yourself.
Amen.
Yeah.
It's you.
Amen.
You are looking at my face. I see
it's
you.
You.
Whether you like or not, it is you.
That's true. Amen.
So, the man now said, hey! What wretched man are you?
Who? My God.
Can you deliver me? Can you imagine that an apostle of God is seeking for deliverance?
Okay.
Everybody needs it.
An apostle of God is now seeking.
Come
on, listen to me. Just because you are anointed, doesn't mean you are
free. No.
Just because you can bring the gospel, doesn't mean you are free.
Yeah.
One time I preached a message, safe, but bad. You can be saved by my mouth. Can you imagine a great apostle of God? And an anointed apostle of God is now asking, who can deliver me?
Amen.
Jesus.
Who?
My God.
And he called himself, what a wretched man I am in this body of destruction, of this body of imprisonment. He said, who is out there that can deliver me? Is it my uncle? Is it my boyfriend? Is it my girlfriend? Is that prayer partner? Is that bishop? Is it the prophet out there who can deliver me? My brother, my sister, hear me very well. Curse and woe be unto any man
who put their trust in their fellow brother or sister. Why? Because, ladies and gentlemen, in times of emergency, in times of adversity, in times of affliction, the Lord said, remove your eyes from everybody and call upon the name. Of the Lord is a strong power, and the righteous run to it, and they are safe.
Amen. Hear me.
Jesus.
Be in the spirit.
Yes. Amen.
Can you imagine a great man of God?
Uh-huh.
Even Jesus himself didn't need
all of us.
No, no, this flesh. Don't care who you are.
Amen.
Amen.
Don't care who you are.
No, 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 no.
The flesh is not a respecter
of no one. Amen. Amen.
Michael Jackson, who used to have millions of people on his stage, that anytime he begins to sing Billy, people will fall under that satanic anointing. Some will die. Some will go into coma just because of his voice. Today, where is Michael Jackson? His flesh has destroyed.
My Lord.
It doesn't matter the name you have. Your flesh can change your story.
Amen. Amen. That's
you
true.
Better depend on God.
Yes.
Be not on your own understanding. But in all, acknowledge that you have a man.
Yes.
A God who never fails.
Amen.
When you call him in that time, he will come and deliver you.
Yes.
When you call him in the waters, I say he is able to deliver you. Somebody shout a big hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Don't depend on anybody.
Amen.
On God.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Let's see who delivered him. Ask him. Ask for the deliverance.
Thanks be to God. Through Jesus Christ.
Through who?
Through Jesus
Christ. So that deliverance right there.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Dreams cannot deliver you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Prophecy without Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
Go ahead.
Laying of hands without Christ.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Now we are going to see the confession. Sit down.
Woo.
The first confession of this great man of God. He confirmed the power within the spirit of God. He said, I know that the law is spirit. When you read 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 16, we learned that Holy Spirit is the portal of scripture. Holy Spirit, you don't have to read. Holy Spirit is the what? Is the author of what? Of scripture. The Bible says all scripture was by his breath. It came by his breath. All scripture is the breath of God. And he said that scripture is profitable for teaching. It's for reproof. It's for correction. Is for training in righteousness. Watch this. So that the man of God may be complete and equipped. So you see, the word of God, hallelujah, is what brings equipping and then completion. Are we getting the point? So this man is confessing that he is not condemning the law at all. He is not condemning the law at all. But you are going to open your eyes. Anytime you hear the word law, ever listen, please, so you don't miss it. Anytime you hear the word law, this is the definition. Holy Ghost gave. Okay? Law simply means doing things by your own knowledge, by your own power, depending on your good things, your good deeds. That one is what we call law. In the olden days, there were many rituals these people must perform in order for God to forgive their sins. They must kill goats. They must bleed blood. They must do that. They must bring grains. They must do all kinds of things for God to have mercy on them. And they thought that by doing all these things brings justification. So in
came to a time that God has to abolish all those things. Mm-hmm. And he said that now, you know what? Sacrifices and blood, I don't really deserve.
Yes. Yes.
But now what? He said, a body.
Yes.
Have I not prepared?
Yes.
He was actually referring to the body of what? Christ.
Yes.
Ever listen, we have what we call the law of what? The law of works. The law of works. Be very careful. Anytime your instinct is telling you that, oh, you pay your tithe, so you are holy. Be very careful. That is works. That is law.
Yes.
Are you getting the point?
Amen.
Be very careful. Anytime that your instinct tells you that, oh, you are better than that sister.
Amen.
Because you dress very good, better than her.
Amen.
That is works.
Amen.
Be very careful. It's law.
Amen.
Be very careful whenever your instinct, hallelujah, raise you above other people. Thinking that you are better than them.
Amen.
Thinking that you can preach better than them. Thinking that you are so anointed than them.
Amen.
That is what is called law.
Amen.
Law is works.
Yes.
So in the days of Jesus, there were two people. Hallelujah. One was a Jew. One was tax collector.
Mm-hmm.
The Jew came forward.
Yes.
And then he said, as for me,
whoosh,
I pay my tithe.
Yeah.
I go to church every day.
Uh-huh.
I fast 3 times a week.
Boast.
So I am holy.
Boast.
I'm not like this one here, this sinner.
Boast.
But the Bible says that the sinner,
yes,
have never paid tithe.
Yes.
The sinner have never come to church activities like the way we come every day. But our heart is not clean.
Amen.
This man accepted. He said,
okay,
I am
a sinner.
Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Have mercy on me.
Yes.
The Bible said that every day, God accepted that man and put the one who depended on his ways.
Yes.
Amen.
So anybody that depends on his ways, hallelujah, grace is not in action. So you that person, on you are on your own, and God is not in it.
Amen.
So what is there are difference between law, which is equal to works, and then grace.
Come on.
Grace, you don't have to work. Grace comes. Yesterday I said it here.
Three.
Grace comes. Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm.
And then grace is a brother to faith.
Yes.
So when grace comes, you have the faith automatically for you to move according to faith.
Mm-hmm.
So when you are moving according to grace.
Mm-hmm.
And grace is connected with faith. And faith comes in to open your eyes for you to know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Have we got the point?
Yeah.
Now, grace doesn't mean control to sin.
Come on.
I'm going somewhere.
Amen.
Grace connects you to faith, and then faith connects you to the truth, and then the truth now guides you. People don't have to tell you what to do anymore.
Uh-huh.
But through the Holy Spirit, you are led,
yes,
by God. Say, there are some things that you are not taught, but because you are walking in grace.
Amen.
And by the mercy of God,
yes,
through His Spirit, your eyes are open to the truth.
Amen.
That is grace.
Hallelujah.
So God is making us understand something here. He said that the law is not to be rejected. The law is true. The law is okay. Somebody shout a big hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So the law and the ritual do not make a person Christian.
Mm-hmm.
The law cannot make a man righteous and acceptable to God. It only points your sin. It only makes you sin more. But guess what? The more you are depending on your own ability to do good, the more you are making mistakes.
Yeah.
Are we getting the point, guys? The more you depend on your good thing, the more you are making mistakes. But when grace comes in and Holy Ghost is in control, you walk by faith in righteousness.
Amen.
So watch what happened here in Romans chapter 3, verse 20. You know, let's go. Yeah, for by what?
For by works of the law, no human being will be justified.
Wait, I love that. Linda, say it so you will understand. For by what?
For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight.
Man of God, did you get it? For by works of the law. For the law I have explained to you, I want you to catch it here. For by the works of the law, no man can believe God. But what, people?
Since through the law comes knowledge of sin.
You see that? So the law always points to your what? To your sin.
Mm-hmm.
But it does not justify you. Are we getting that one? So when you read the book of Romans, chapter 4, verse 2 to 5. Let's see what the scripture talks about Abraham as an example, so that we will get the picture. Keep on.
So if Abraham was justified by works.
Wait. If Abraham is justified by what works, keep on.
He has something to boast about.
Then he has something to boast about.
But not before God.
But not before God.
For what does the scripture say?
What does the scripture say? Now listen.
Abraham believed God.
Abraham just believed.
And it was counted to him.
And it was counted to him as righteous. So now, you see the difference between works.
Come on.
The Bible said that Abraham was not accepted by God according to works, but according to faith. Faith is the same as belief.
Hallelujah.
So the Bible said he believed, and then it was counted to him as righteous. Continue.
Now to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as his due.
Did you hear that? Anyone who works, it is your own. Your own thing that you are doing. Holy Ghost is not in it. It's not part of it. If you are working according to the law, you are on your own. Let's see.
And to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness.
Uh-oh. Are we getting it? But the one who does not work, but what? Believe. Believe is what? Equal to what?
Faith.
That person is accounted to him as what? Righteousness. So I'm giving you a secret here. Okay, guys, hello. Listen. Then Paul wouldn't have been called apostle. He was an apostle, and yet he has confessions. Hello? Was he righteous?
Yes.
But the guy had what problems?
Yeah.
Does that make him unbelieved?
No.
Will you get the picture now? Because Paul is not walking by works.
That's right. Amen.
But by faith, even though he's a sinner, and he has errors, and this errors is confessing to you, that this is what I'm going to do. But he's walking by faith. Faith is a substance of things, not sin.
Yes.
An evidence of things. Hallelujah.
Oh
my God. But yet, you believe.
Amen.
Yes.
So this body, within the body, we don't know what we are encountering every day, but by faith, we are walking there in the body.
Yeah.
By faith, hallelujah, we are doing this in the body. How is it working? It's by the power of the Holy Spirit. So Paul did not condemn the law, since the book of Psalms 19:7 says, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Number two, confession of Paul. Paul said to himself that, I am unspiritual. I am unspiritual, meaning he is not spiritual. He said he is carnal. He said he was a slave to sin. Hallelujah. He said he was in this helpless body. He was in this helpless body that is sold under sin. He said that his carnal life has become so helpless that now he don't know what to do. And he said that the things that he wants to do, he cannot do them. It has become an unceasing struggle in his life. So he recognized, he knows what he is doing, but he can't stop. There are some of you here, you know that what you are doing is wrong. You have the perception, you have the idea, you know that this thing that I am doing is not right. But the question here is, why can't you stop? It's a mystery. Hallelujah. So the carnal man himself is doing things. The man is carrying out things that is not contrary to God's law. But
He does not even understand why he's doing them. If you are here and you are doing things and you don't understand why you are doing them, that thing becomes a mystery. So you fight. The man fights. He struggles against all these things in the body, all these things around him. But before he knew it, before he knows it, he is still in captivity. He finds himself sinning. He finds himself doing the same thing over and over. His body has brought him short to the glory of God. Most of us, we have come short to the glory of God. Why? Because of the power and the strength of our body. Somebody shout, amen.
Amen.
So he says something that's very powerful. That's my number 2 point. He says, the things I hope to do, the things I will, the things I want to do, these are the things that I cannot do. These are the things that I cannot do. Those things I want to do, I can do them. I want to do the right thing. I want to please God. As I walk through this journey of life day by day, I want to be conformed to the image of Christ. I want to become all that God wants me to become. But despite the desire and the expectation, before God, I am always a sinner. Why? Because the flesh will not allow me. How many of you are in this house and struggling, you are fighting, you are battling to overcome your weakness, your sinful nature. But anytime, despite what you do, you always see yourself come short. They are going somewhere because everybody needs deliverance in this house.
Amen.
In the book of Galatians chapter 5 verse 17, Linda, let's go. Galatians chapter 5 verse 17.
For the desires of the flesh are against the spirit.
Do you hear that? So we have two desires in the human body. The desire of the flesh and the desire of the spirit. And by here he said that the desire of the flesh is against what?
The spirit.
Keep on.
And the desires of the spirit are against the flesh.
What happened?
For these are opposed to each other.
These are war. They are warriors. They are fighting against each other. They are fighting against what? Each other. Keep on.
To keep you from doing the things you want to do.
To keep you away from the things of God. From the law of the mind. Glory be to his name. Finish it.
But if you are led by the Spirit.
But if you are led by the Spirit.
You are not under the law.
Oh, hello. So are we getting the picture now? So now, anytime you hear the law, is what? It's works. Your own what? Understanding, ability, power. But he said that anybody who walks in the what? In the spirit, you are not under works.
Amen.
You are not under law.
Amen.
You walk by.
Amen.
So if you are here and you are boasting, that as for me, I come to church every day. As for me, I pay for my tithe. As for me, I pray 5 times a day. My brother and sister, stop saying those things.
Amen.
I know people who don't have the strength to pray like the way you do. But anytime they stand in your corner with that glorious heart,
amen.
Oh my God, with that virgin heart, there's something we call virgin heart. They don't know anything.
Amen.
They are trying their best.
Amen.
They can pray 3 hours like you.
Amen.
They can pray 5 hours like you. But the little prayer they can offer to God, if they can do it wholeheartedly, God will come and deliver them from your problem.
Hallelujah.
So if by faith and grace that we are saved, it's not by your works. Then Jesus would have abandoned the disciples when he came and found them sleeping. Because they were so fatigued. Their body was so weak. And Jesus had all the right to be mad at them. But he knew and he mentioned it. He said that I know that the spirit desire, but the flesh is weak. If Jesus Christ understood your weakness, how dare you pointing fingers to at one another?
Amen.
Yes. And raising yourself above them.
Amen.
Making yourself king and yourself of people.
Amen.
name of righteousness.
Amen.
I'm here to tell you, nobody's righteous.
Amen.
If you think you're righteous, then help your brother to get there.
Hallelujah.
We must rise. In this last age, we must help one another. The Bible says, you see your brother.
That you fail to reach
what happened? Flesh. The rest of the ants will not help you. Brother, my sister, we are dealing with many things that people must rise and begin to resolve their lives. Or else, you may think you are holy, but then you are going to hell.
Amen. Yes, that's true.
We must depend on God. That is why we tell the church that, guys, ladies and gentlemen, when you wake up in the morning, the best prayer you can pray is the Father, forgive me.
Yes.
Forgive me. Yes. Restore my life.
Yes.
Refresh my life.
Amen.
Help me with the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Teach me your way.
Amen.
Show me and guide me.
Yes.
Anytime you wake up, right, guys, every morning, read Psalm 119. Every morning. Psalm 119 is a very long chapter. Very long. You read it. It talks about the word of God and the Holy Spirit. God will help you through His word. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
Paul, make another confession that I want everybody to listen very well. He made a confession and he said, he found two laws in his body. Hey! And this is what I'm going to explain it very deep. So everybody listen very well. The laws. Number one law that he found. Let me copy my thing so that I will not forget. Because I've put them in here in my notes. And I want everybody to catch it. It's very important. Oh yes, Lord Jesus. We give you praise. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
Okay, I got it. He found two what? Laws. The law of the flesh, which is the law of sin. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
The law of the flesh, or the law of what?
Sin.
Hallelujah. He said, I found this thing within me. So we are going to deal with the law of sin, or the law of the flesh. Sin is a law. Sin is a law. Why is sin a law? Write this down. Sin is called a law because it rises up and rules over our time. It rises within the members, within your body, and rules over you. Rule over man's affairs. So it's a law. What does law do? It rules. Controls. America have a law. If you are, guys, if you do it, if you are not careful and you abuse one law, you are in danger. No matter how anointed you are, you will find yourself in jail.
Amen.
That is law. Sin is law because of its permanent and controlling power. Sin, it doesn't matter how anointed you are, it can control you. It has power to control you. And it's permanent. If you're not careful, it will make sure that it will permanent your life where you are, and you will think that what you are doing is right. Hallelujah. Do you know that in the book of Thessalonians, sin is called mystery? The mystery of lawlessness.
Yes.
Do you know that? It's in the Bible. They call it mystery. Sin is mystery. Because you, the enemy can make you commit something that you think that it's okay.
Yes, that's true.
You will never know. That is why it's called mystery.
Mm-hmm.
Anything that is mystery and you don't know, when you are doing that, you think it's okay.
Yeah. My God.
Watch this. Righteousness also is mystery. That is why you must what? Have the revelation to live in it.
Yes.
So the other day, what Jesus said? Jesus said that, oh Father, thank you for what? For opening this one's eyes. For them to see the light of the gospel. So the light of the gospel is mission.
Yes.
And sin also is mission.
Yes. Wow.
So you can be doing something if you know that in America here now, homosexual. So now do you know what the African people are doing now? If I tell you right, you guys will not believe it. I was very young. I don't know why they're doing that. It's very bad.
they are in here, right? And they are marrying people. I'm talking about a guy is marrying a guy. But you know, it's not real. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, just because American people say that homosexual is not legal, right? So if homosexual is legal, then I can what? Farm a paper.
Wow.
From my own cousin or a brother or whatever and say that it's my wife.
What? Oh, yeah.
Are you getting a point? Because you are, he's a law, then you say, oh, you get changed. So I can say that, well, even though that's my brother, and I'll say that that's my what?
Yeah, your husband.
Yeah. Yeah. What can you request at all?
Yeah.
Hey, guys, I'm telling you, people are doing things in the name of law, thinking that it is what? It is right.
Jesus!
So law is mischief.
My
the law of Satan is pushing you. You can sit in the house of God and do some evil things.
Yes.
And you will think that it is
yes.
What?
Yes, that's true.
My God. You have to be very careful. Write it down. Sin is a law because it is impossible to break its rule and to keep it from sinning. Sin is very guys, without Christ. It is impossible to break the rules of sin.
Mm-hmm.
Without Jesus Christ, you lie. Doesn't matter who you are, you can prove to yourself to be a macho.
Okay.
I said sin is not afraid of you.
That's right. Yes. Yes. Amen.
Hmm. Look at Samson, who was bigger and stronger than Samson?
Yes.
Yet sin was able to go out in that
place.
Hallelujah.
Some of you, me. The devil cannot check. One time I was praying, and excuse my language, I used this word on the devil. B word. While I was praying. Because the guy was bombarding my mind with all kinds of things. So I started praying, calling him all kinds of things. You come to a point that I'll go like this. Ah! Where are you? Sometimes when you want to live holy, you want to go to the you can't see it.
I know that's not true.
And sometimes when people come around and say, oh, sister, are you okay? Hey. You are mad already.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
Because of what you're going through on the inside.
Yeah.
So you want to add everybody to it.
Uh-huh.
So nobody was in the house with me. It was only me. And the thing that I was going through, right, I got up and I said, Lucifer, where are you? And so I'm going like this. It's crazy, the one that is helping you to break the
heaven.
Wow. 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 Wow.
Yeah. Amen. Oh, amen.
Well, yes. Did you hear what I said?
Yes.
You cannot insult the one that is helping you to break the heaven.
Yes, amen.
Did Jesus insult Judas?
No.
What's happening?
Yes. Yes.
Because Judah was not the heavy.
Yeah.
There's still a friendly terrorist.
Yeah.
Why? Because without Lucifer, my God, Job cannot be proved righteous.
Amen.
They were sleeping with their own mother in the book of Corinthians. And what happened? And then Paul said, such person take him and hand him over to Satan. Why? Satan. So that so
sick.
When you find yourself in the wilderness and you yourself will go through some experience that you don't want you, you begin to think.
Yes, that's true.
And it helps you to repent.
Right.
And get back to God.
My God.
That's what it means. So sometimes when somebody is pulling a man in a church, you just want them to sit down. And let's let them deal with them. Sin is more. Write it down. Because it has captivated and enslaved the nature of man. It has what? Captivated and enslaved the nature of what? Of man. Sin is a law. Write it down. Because it is not passive but active. Constantly struggling to gain the ascendancy over the law of the mind. Somebody shout, amen?
Amen.
So sin is very powerful. You have to make sure that you always pray so that God can deliver you. It's only Jesus Christ that can deliver you from sin.
Yes.
Somebody shout, amen?
Amen?
Now let's go to the law of the mind. The law of the mind simply means the law of the spirits or the soul within you. Somebody shout, amen?
Amen?
The law, we have the law of the mind, the law of the spirit within you. The law of the mind within you simply means the divine nature of God implanted within your life. The divine what? Nature of God. Anybody who is captivated by sin, you don't have the nature of God. The law of the mind, hallelujah, introduce the nature of God to your life. Hallelujah.
Amen.
In the book of 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. Let's go. 2 Peter 1, 4.
2 Peter 1, 4.
By which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises, so that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of sinful desires.
You see that? You see that? So you see that becoming a partaker of his divine nature, escaping the corruption that is in the world through lust. Somebody shout a big hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So that is what it means. The inward mind, the inward law, transform one to be conformed to the nature of God. Hallelujah. And then number two, the law of the inward man simply means the new man created within the believer's life after he or she is born again. So the scripture says, be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Are we at the point? So the inward law are what I am giving you right now. And then the number three, the law of the mind simply means the abiding presence of Christ in the believer's life. The scripture says, and I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you, and the day ye shall know that I am in the Father, and ye in me, and I in you. So are we getting the picture here?
Amen.
So Jesus is trying to say here to us that the law of the mind are those who have the abiding presence
of Jesus Christ. If you have the law of the mind, right? It simply means that Christ is always present. It simply means that you are always led by the Holy Spirit. How pity it is to see people who call themselves and profess the name of Christ, and yet they don't have the presence of the Holy Spirit.
My God.
They don't have the presence of God.
My God.
You know why? Because it's either you have the law of the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
If you have the law of the flesh, Jesus is not present.
Hallelujah.
If you have the law of the flesh, Jesus is not present.
Because 12 midnight is the time that satanic activity is ruling the air.
And now guess what they do? They look in the body of human beings.
Oh my God.
When they see that you have no soul,
yeah,
they come and take it. It's easy for them.
Yes.
You have no guarantee. You have no seed. Hmm. With that person, you are dead.
Hmm.
So it means that now you anything can take you out. Hmm. There are some of you just headache can cause you to die. You know why? Because your soul is not in you.
You, Jesus.
There are some of you, oh, you know what? She just complained that she had a bronchitis. What happened? The person died.
Mm-hmm.
Or the person was just complaining that their knee was bleeding. Just that. The person could not breathe. Just that. What happened? There is no name for it. The spiritual name is that you don't have a soul.
Jesus.
Many of you, sin is taking your soul away. Little by little. So the Bible says that resist.
Mm.
Use the word resist.
Resist.
Yes.
And
you will flee. Yes. 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 So find a way to get out away from
the flesh.
The flesh.
Mm.
I am still fighting man.
Yeah.
What about you?
Yes.
What about sister? We must run.
Yes.
Because the Lord was rebuking me and he said that we don't have time. We must fight and begin to fight. Don't wait for a man of God to come and fight for you.
Amen. Amen.
Don't wait for prayer towers to pray for you.
Amen.
My brother, my sister, your flesh is your own battle.
Yeah.
You must fight it.
Yeah.
Someone is shouting.
Amen.
When you are in the flesh, you fight unnecessary battles. When you are in the flesh, everything concerns you. Somebody shouting.
Amen.
Somebody may ask the man of God, how do you kill flesh? How do you kill flesh? How many of you are ready to hear this so that we can pray?
Amen.
How do you kill your flesh?
Amen.
Okay. See ya. Act as if you are dead and lay on the floor. A dead person don't have any feelings.
Amen.
You know what I say?
Amen.
I say a dead person don't have what?
Amen.
You will hit a dead person, boom! She will not get up.
Amen.
You will do whatever you want to do.
Amen.
Because the soul,
amen,
is not around.
Amen.
It's the soul that makes you feel.
That's the life.
Oh. Go ahead. So I'm saying that you're watching this. This man cannot feel anything at all. She's dead.
Mm-hmm.
So God wants you to die to the flesh. When you die to the flesh, right? When somebody is attacking you, you don't feel it.
That's right.
Yes.
Amen.
That's right. Hello, someone cannot get it.
Yes. Amen.
Because you are dead.
Amen. Amen. That's
so when you are dead and somebody is doing something that will provoke you,
uh-huh,
you don't feel it. You are the wrong person. You don't feel it. Because the body is not around.
Amen.
I like that.
Amen. Amen.
Because the body is not what? It's
amen,
not around. The body is dead. Now the spirit is in control.
Amen.
So how can you preach the spirit?
Amen. That's right.
Are we getting the point?
Yes.
How can you find the ghost and preach the ghost?
Yes, Lord.
So, Shinika, when somebody look at you and begin to gossip about you, I don't even feel it.
Amen.
What is another day for sin? Offense. What is another name for offense? Stumbling. The word stumbling simply means that you are walking and then all of a sudden something is
yeah.
Well, guess what? The works and the activities of the flesh is what we call stumbling. So, example, gossip is stumbling.
Yes.
So, let's say that you have come across something that will stumble you and is in your way. And they are what? They are just talking. All you have to do is because as a man or a woman in the spirit, you don't stumble first. But Holy Ghost open your eyes to see the stumbling block.
Yeah. Yeah.
So now when you see it, all you gotta do.
Yeah, that's it.
You don't have time.
No.
You said another one. Oh. You want to explain yourself to every situation.
Amen.
You want to talk to everybody concerning what is going on.
Amen.
Hey, I will kill you.
Amen.
You don't have time.
Amen.
don't want to repent. He said, he, Jesus, has become what? A stumbling block. And then he used the word, a stone of offense.
Yes.
And he said, anybody that will fall on it, the stone will not
crush.
So that means that you too, you have a stone.
Amen.
But when it comes, guys, what?
Jump over. Jump over. Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
So it's either you take over your stumbling block, or else
he'll take
the stumbling block of Jesus will crush.
Yes.
That's right.
Kill the flesh.
Amen.
Because if you don't kill it, it will become the stone of offense. Why are you so worried?
Mm-hmm.
Because of what people are saying.
Okay.
Hello?
Amen.
Why are you so worried?
Amen. Amen.
Do you know why I don't worry about people? Mm-hmm. When they talk.
Mm-hmm.
If you like, right? Go to CNN.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Go and find yourself. You don't even have money to pay for them. You go to them and talk about what Pastor Mike have done, about what see, this is that I've done, I've done what you have done. I don't care.
Amen.
Okay.
Amen.
Keep the verdict. Amen. Keep the verdict. Amen. Hallelujah.
If you like, say whatever you want to say.
Okay.
I have passed that.
That's right. Take a fish and
fry. Don't worry about what people want.
Amen.
Say.
Amen.
My daughter, on, don't on. Worry about it.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Ooh, Jesus.
Watch this. Oh, because of Clem B, I'm not coming to church anymore.
Okay.
Oh, why? What happened? Yeah, because of the way she always look at me and I'm saying, so can you imagine that? Can you see that stumbling block right there?
Yeah.
What stumbling block?
Yeah.
And because of that stumbling block, watch this. You are being refrained from fulfilling the purpose of God in that place just because of somebody. You couldn't cross over. You have allowed the stumbling block to keep you away from the purpose and the plans of God. Now, Paul made all the confessions wretched I am. What a wretched man I am. And then he used the word, I need deliverance. Who can deliver me? Kevin, I see your body physically looking very glorious, superlicious, beautiful, glorious. But on the inside, nobody knows what you're going through. Hello, some of you, you have put bones, wet, all kinds of things on your face. You are looking so glorious, shining. When a man talks to you, oh yes, I'm doing well, I'm going to die. But within you, you know that there is no peace. Paul was crying out. He said, church, I've made my confession to you, but I need a deliverer. Who can deliver me? Some of you are hiding your troubles. You are hiding your problems. You are hiding your weakness. Why? Sometimes I come to a man of God, man of God, this is what I'm going to help you. You will help me. I want everybody to examine your heart right now. What are you going to do that nobody knows? Hello? What are you going to do that nobody knows except you? And you know that you need deliverance, but you are not talking. Because you think that you can solve the problem your own. Today, God cannot deliver you until you begin to confess them. Hello? Can I have a white? Can I have a white? Do you guys have a white? Any white clothes here? Anybody have a white cloth? Give me. Give me that one too. You're going to act like I was a person. You're going to act like you are a patient, okay? And you are very sick. I'm the doctor. Okay? Go all the way there and walk as if there is nothing wrong with me. Come back. Come slow. Bronchitis. Please turn around for me. I have a problem right here. It's called elephantiasis. And then it's time to check the pulse.
Tell me what you're doing.
Yes.
Woo.
Tell you. You win, right? You win. You will.
Yeah.
The lady died from breast cancer. Because the lady knew the reason why she had a breast cancer, but she never confessed it. And she died. Some of you are going to your grave because of secrets. Man of God is asking a question. You do this?
I never. Man of God, no. You can believe me now.
You have lied to God.
Yeah.
Why is it that Roman Catholic people always go to the priest and beg confession?
Yeah.
Confession heals your soul.
Yeah.
Some of you don't want to confess, you don't want to do anything.
Yeah.
You want to keep this to yourself. Tonight, we are going to pray. You're going to ask God to have mercy on you. Tell God to set you free. Tell God to heal your what? Your soul, your flesh, your body. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
You're on your feet.
I sing praises to your name.
Come on, somebody, let's sing it.
Oh, praises to your name. Oh, Lord. For your name is great and worthy to be praised.
I sing praises to your name. Let's go one more time.
I sing praises.
I see praises
Michael
all the time.
Obed,
Jesus.